Hello. Okay. Hello, everyone. Welcome. Thanks for coming to the Lightning Talks. As you all know, the booth crawl is like going to be right after this, so we'll try to get you there on time. We have a lot of great content. That's why you're all here. So let me welcome up real fast Elizabeth Joseph. She's going to be talking about status.openstack.org.
Thank you. All right, so what I'm doing here is just going to give you a tour of this page, status.openstack.org, because I often find out, what is that? Not now. Should I upgrade? All right, oftentimes I run into people who don't actually know what all these links at the top here are for, so I'm just going to do a quick tour of what this all is. So the first one, a lot of people are probably familiar with, it's the Zool status page. This will load up things that are in the check queue, so when you upload a patch, you can see your patch here. You just want to search down, you can search the page for your patch number. You'll see how it's doing and whether it's, Yeah, there's a filter up top. Oh yes, you can filter using the filter as well. look, you can sort by projects or reviews. Okay. and then once your patch has been approved, it'll go in the gate queue and you can find it in this list. And then there are other, the post queue and post release post and other things you can see on this page. It pretty much gives you an idea where your patch is while it's being tested. This is probably the most well-known page on status.openstack. You then have the Elastic Recheck page. When the Elastic Recheck bot comes into your patch and says, I think you hit this bug, it means someone has already categorized the specific bug you ran into, and it's usually either a known problem, it is definitely a known problem, either it's in infrastructure or it's in the test has a known bug, or other things that have been happening that the developers already know about, and it's not your patch, it just happens to be something you ran into. So the Recheck page is a really nice page to go to if you're looking for the things that are popping up, especially the uncharacterized tab here, which will show you failures that have happened but have not yet been put into bugs and are not really being tracked in the system. We then have the reviews tab. So this has a bunch of early projects for OpenStack because no one has used this page in a very long time. But the idea of this project was that people wanted to see reviews sorted by importance. So taking information from Launchpad based on various criteria, this takes all the reviews in a project and sorts them presumably by some sort of review thing that makes sense. So the top review this system thinks is the most important review to go through. So you can go scroll down here a lot. Where's the page down? Here we go. So yeah, you can see Glance is on here, a bunch of different projects. All open source, so you can add your project to this list if it's not already there. I don't have time for questions. Yes, I'm getting to that. So a lot of people don't use this, and a lot of people have started creating dashboards for Gertty. So one thing we added, I think a couple weeks ago, was a link to this Neutron dashboard that was created by the Neutron team. I can't actually bring it up because you need to be logged into Gertty to see the results, and I don't want to bring up Paul's Gertty, even if you are logged in. but if you click on the Gertty dashboard link for Neutron, it'll bring up prioritized reviews inside of Gertty itself. So rather than using Review Day, probably will eventually morph into using a series of dashboard links like Neutron has already done. So that's pretty cool. So the next one we have is Bug Day, and this one is used even less than Review Day. But the idea here was that the bugs are listed, pulled from Launchpad for a bunch of different projects, and it shows the status of the bug, and then it tracks them on this graph. So the idea was that teams were supposed to have bug days, and when they have a bug day, they can look in the next day and see how this graph dropped in the bug numbers. And that's really inspiring and exciting if people did bug days. So some projects do. I don't know if they actually look at this, but if they did, it would be pretty cool to see. Infra did bug days, but I don't think we're even on here. We moved off to Launchpad, so we wouldn't. We might have used to been on there, so it was fun to see how the stats went down. So we're almost done, but we're going to go to one of the bigger ones that's pretty new. Matthew Trinish did a whole talk this morning on OpenStack Health this morning. So there's there's a whole talk worth of material here. But essentially, OpenStack Health was trying to give developers a view into the health of the gate and the CI system. So you'll see here a graph of the total jobs run. So the blue is how many jobs passed, and the red is the failures. So overall, you can see how many jobs are passing each day over time and the failures. You can then dig into the jobs, so you can search through a certain project and see if a certain project has more failures. If you scroll down, lost my focus, okay. You can see things like, you can go into all these different specific tests, specific runs, and see what actually failed. Scrolling down a bit more, you can see by project what projects have the most failures happening. And then this is also, you can also search it and then drill into these things. And have fun by yourself. That is all the time I have.
Thanks, Elizabeth. All right, Paul, your laptop is already up here, so this helps.
Hello, so I'll try and keep it quick and fast here. So we added grafana.openstack.org, I think about 6 months ago. If people don't know, Grafana is basically an open source dashboard rendering project. The reason why I wanted to add it, because this is something we have already, which is called Graphite, and it's actually a very terrible interface on how to graph stuff. And I'm not going to go into it, but we use this today for the Zool page on status.openstack.org to look at the very pretty graphs on the bottom. So one of the problems, obviously, was when we wanted to add Grafana in, we wanted to give users the ability to create their own dashboards. So for example, we have the node pool dashboard, and these are live stats that show what's going on in the queue. But we wanted contributors to be able to control this, and we didn't want to have to set up LDAP and do it like an OpenID backend or something, or so on and so forth. And we needed the ability to do code reviews on this, and it's hard to do code reviews on just native Grafana. So doing the infra way, we wrote our own little tool to take YAML and basically convert it directly into JSON and then post it to the local instance of Grafana, generating the dashboard. And it's heavily driven by Jenkins Job Builder, or JJB, which is the tooling that we use for our Jenkins jobs. So ultimately, where are we here? So we have in project config is the user side of the infrastructure configuration, a Grafana dashboard, or a Grafana folder, and in the folder you can see all of our YAML files. Basically, there's one special file called data source, which controls the back end in Grafana to where to get its stats from, which is graphite.openstack.org. And then every other little file that you see is basically the YAML file for a specific dashboard. So I was just looking at the node pool dashboard. I'm kind of pecking here because I'm holding the mic. So this is basically the YAML file for it. And like I said, it's almost a direct mapping from YAML to JSON and JSON to YAML, except we've added in some basic validation so that when you push your YAML file up into the code review, GraphYAML runs and actually validates that you're not putting in, crafted, stuff to hack the server or something like that. We just say, is it an integer? Is it positive? Is it negative? Stuff like that. It's pretty dry, of what it does, but these targets are actually the statsd namespaces for pulling in all the information. And like I said, it's really a tool to give developers in OpenStack the ability to craft and create their own Grafana dashboards, kind of like the infra way. And that's really all that I have on it, and I know I'm kind of short on, or haven't used all my time, but I'm not gonna sit up here and ramble, so that's basically it.
Yay. Thank you, thanks Paul. All right, here we got Jim. Yes, all right. Going to do the switcheroo. I guess I should entertain you in the meantime.
Interpretive dance.
Yep. Laugh it up.
how quickly can we set up mirroring? And oh, yay, desktop of the year right there. It's all you.
Thank you. Sorry for violating the cardinal rule of lightning talks and using my own laptop, but I promise I have a good reason. I'm going to violate the other cardinal rule, which is don't do live demos. So this is a program that I wrote called Gertty. It's a console-based interface to the Garrett code review system that we all know and love, except some of us maybe don't love its web interface quite as much as we're supposed to. I love text interfaces. I write my code in a text editor, not a web browser, and I run my code in a shell, not a web browser. Some people do that, I understand, but I don't. So for me, like doing all of the code review in a console application makes perfect sense. So anyway, I wrote this thing called Gertty. It interfaces with Garrett over the REST API, but it does something a little bit more than that. It actually syncs all of the data that it needs to work with down locally. So it has a local copy of quite a lot of the database that's in Garrett so that it can do, it can be more responsive. You don't have to be on the internet. You don't have to be on a fast internet. You could be on a plane or you could be in New Zealand and it'll work just as well. Similarly, for all the metadata that's in a database, all of the actual code is in your Git repositories, like the same ones that you're working with anyway. So you can easily do things like check code out into your working repo straight from your code review system. So anyway, when you start Gertty, this is what it looks like. It's a list of all the projects that you're subscribed to. So you can scroll through that. I recently added this thing called project topics, so you can like group projects together. If you wanted to get, you know, we have a lot of Puppet projects in infra, right? And so maybe you want to focus on them, or maybe you want to focus on not them. So you can group them that way and find them. It'll show you how many open changes are in each project, how many things have been you've reviewed. When you open up a project, here's the list of unreviewed changes. This looks kind of like a change list in Garrett, except that it also kind of looks like a mail reader or a news reader, and it starts threading changes together if they're dependent on each other. That's not on accident. you can open up these changes, and there's a screen here that looks, again, not entirely by accident. Let me zoom out a little bit. Okay, I'm not going to zoom out. Anyway, you can see all the information that's on the Garrett change screen. It's got dependencies on other changes, the files that are changed. You can see comments on there. You can open up the diff, and it'll show you a side-by-side diff of the change. If you prefer unified diff, there's a config option, so you can do that. You can leave inline comments, just as you would expect on the old and new sides there, right? You can go back, and you can review changes, leave. I don't even know what I'm looking at here, so I probably shouldn't approve this. There's that. Oh, there's what else is neat? You can do. I'm actually offline right now. If you see at the top, it says offline sync 8. Gertty knows that it's not connected to the internet right now, and so it's not even going to try to sync things. If it were to get online, that sync counter would start counting down on things it knows that it needs to do to catch up the local and remote states. So anyway, you can do what I've been doing. You can leave these comments. You can leave reviews. When you land, Gertty will start pushing those up for you asynchronously. If it detects any discrepancies, like you gave a +2 after somebody else gave a -1 while you were in the air, it'll actually hold that for you and alert you to the to that situation so that you don't look like an idiot. yeah. Supports searching for things in line, like unless, right? So you can, interactive search, all kinds of things. So it's a fun little thing. We're adding things to it all the time. Of course, it is in OpenStack's Garrett up here. So OpenStack/Gertty is the Git repo name. You can check it out from there. You can check out this branch, and you'll be running the thing that I'm actually showing you right now. It's fun. You should try it out and contribute some changes if you feel like it. Thanks. Yes, it'll work with any Garrett.
Thank you, Jim. Now we're going to learn how to add in the Big Tent a project. Andreas.
Thanks. Sorry for having slides and no live demo. So you can all read in the info manual what I'm telling you now. So if you take one thing away from my lightning talk, use our info manual, use the creator's guide and read through it. I'll try to give a very short 5-minute overview of that and only of the technical side of it. Because you all know, if you contribute to OpenStack and part of the community, that there is much more than a repository to it. There's the OpenStack way of doing development, of working in the open, the four opens especially, and all of that is documented in the project team guide together with the processes. We in Infra only support you with those processes. And I want to show some of that, how we support that. So open source, you need a repository where you want to work on. You can also work without a repository. So all of that, Infra handles all its configuration changes, like Paul already said. We do it the same way like developers do. It's a Git repository that you propose changes to, that gets tested, gets reviewed, gets merged, and then is active. So you check out the project config repository, can make changes to Grafyaml or make changes to Garrett projects.yaml, add your project there, and you can also import an existing repository. But that's also your, and the upstream word here is important. That doesn't mean that the upstream version that's just imported, it's misnamed. So keep that in mind. It's also your chance to clean up the repository, remove any branches, any text that you don't want, or if you split a repository, use Git filter to only use those history of the file and the files that you want to have a clean repository that you can work on and start with. We want to do open development. That means in OpenStack having a core team that can abandon a patch, that can do approve a patch, set the workflows, and do the usual default ZEPI set. So you need to create that ACL file for it. You also want to run tests on OpenStack. I hope you do. You can merge without tests, but you should. If it's a Python project, the minimal test that you do is the Python jobs, which is a job group, which is some syntactic sugar that we use here and defines jobs in Jenkins. So keep in mind, Jenkins defines what to run, and then you tell it in the Zool layout file, when to run it, when to trigger it. So only changing one file will not help you, because either you define jobs that are not run, that are not triggered at all, or you trigger some jobs that are nowhere defined. So you need both parts of that, and that's the most important part for you to take away. Also, if you're changing the project config and want to enhance your project going forward. What's also important is that those two, Jenkins and Zool, are different projects, different namespaces. So they share the namespace of the job name, but the syntactic sugar we use here. The job templates on the one side, the Python jobs, the PyP jobs is something totally different, it's completely unknown on the Zool side. Here the Python jobs is a job template that will define that the PEP8, the Python 27 and so on jobs are run in the check and in the gate queue. And we have published to PP, which publishes your repository when you take it. What else do you want to do? You want to communicate. You want to communicate on IRC channel. So set up GarrettBot channels.yaml and define conditions when your projects should get notifications of mergers or of new patches. Give OpenStack bots and the admins access to it in the access bot file, And if you want to log about it and have the status command, so system-wide messages, you need to do that in the system config repository. Here it's also important that so that you can use, for example, also the success command and tell the community about success, and then Mike will explain that in the next week newsletter. You also need to set up in other systems, not this. So once you have done all that, you can commit your change and get it up for review. You also need to set up bug area in Launchpad and PP for publishing. If you are a big tent project, you also want to make a change for governance and add perhaps publishing for docs OpenStack.org or set up the translation workflow. And all of that together is explained in the info manual in the creator's guide, as I said before. So just in time.
Amazing. That was to explain on adding a project to OpenStack in less than 5 minutes.
That's how long it actually takes, right? Five minutes there should be in, right?
Yeah. Yeah. All right, so now we're going to hear about one of my favorite subjects, CI, but enabling a better CI experience. So here we go. Take it away, Moshi.
Yes, it's more like enable better CI when you have hardware dependency. Okay, I'm Moshe Levy from Mellanox, a software engineer. So today in OpenStack, as you know, there are several features that are heavily dependent on the hardware. Features like PCI pass-through, where you need to pass through the hardware to the guest. So you need a special PCI device, SROV for networking. You need SROV card that support, you need a network adapter that support SROV. If you're using ISO, for example, you need, which is ISCSI over RDMA, you need a network adapter that support RDMA. So as you know, in OpenStack, you need to have a good stable CI to test all the features. And these features are a little bit more difficult to test because they are hardware dependent. So why it's so hard to test these features with CI? So first of all, you need physical servers, and you need lots of physical servers because it depends on the amount of the Jenkins job and the load balancing of the all the jobs, and you don't want that. The Jenkins will report like after 3 days. You want like a quick report like after a few hours. Also, it requires you the hardware device. So in our case, we in Mellanox, we're using network card. So you need the network card in each physical server. And that's saying a network card in each physical server. So that means lots of network cards. And you may want to test it with also different configurations of the hardware, of the hardware device. This means, again, lots of physical servers and lots of the hardware device. And the cleaning part, which is a difficult part for us. So you, after the job ends, you want to bring the physical device to its initial state. And then again, you have two possibilities, either do re-imaging this, and that bring complexity to your CI environment, and also takes time, or you can try to do what we are doing today, is like just removing DevStack and some Python packages, and hopefully you did the cleanup of the physical server, but that's not always works. So what we want to achieve in a perfect world, we want to reduce the numbers of physical servers. We would like to somehow to eliminate the hardware device dependency. We want to do it, test it on a variety of hardware devices and maybe on a variety of hardware device configuration. So we thought about it in Mellanox how to solve this problem, and we said, why not simulate the real hardware? And the idea is, just a second. No, you. So the idea is like adding a module of a hardware simulator to QMU. So So it will be like removing the hardware dependency. So how this CI environment will look like? So basically, you got the virtual machine that's running the Jenkins and Zool, which is like most CIs. But on the right, you can see that I've got now a QMU process with the hardware simulator module. And this can be like a different hardware simulator per guest. And in the guest itself, you see the DevStack environment VM with all the hardware configuration that you need. So this basically reducing the number of physical servers because we are going to a virtualized environment, and also we don't need actually our NICs. So or in each case the physical device. So it's basically. Our CI environment is becoming less complicated. So just a bit dive into, so you have the QMU process, which containing the guest with which has the DevStack environment or whatever way you want to install the OpenStack. And in it, you have the device driver that actually, is the vendor device hardware, right? But instead of talking to the actual hardware itself, it's talking to something that's in QMU that's simulate the hardware device. So it's removing entirely the hardware dependency. This is like a summary of, that's it? Okay, so no, that's fine, it's just summary of how we do it and what the benefit of it. Thank you.
Thank you, Moshi. All right.
Yeah. The spotlights are very strong. Oh, God. Sorry, if you want to see my beautiful eyes, come to me after that.
I wish I had glasses like you.
Yeah.
All right, can we switch to HDMI, or do I have to do something special? Sweet. Cool. All right, so I got Tomos and Heiko. Yep, so how to drive downstream packagers mad. Thank you.
All right, so this is my friend Heiko Gemar, who's doing packages in Fedora for the last 10 years, and he does all things RPM for OpenStack in RDU.
And here's Thomas Guaron, who works at Marantis and is packaging OpenStack and Debian since the Cactus release. So let's start. We love you, but spreading bad news in a nice way is hard. But
yeah, so we've seen the same mistakes repeating over and over again. So we have the choice to either say to like here in the most nice way possible, or to just complain about someone. Oh, you did a bad thing. So we obviously prefer the former. So.
And OpenStack is huge. We have 300 source packages, and we can't pet every single package. After all, there is only one of us.
Yes, because he's only one doing RDU. I'm nearly the only one doing Debian. So. So the types of problems we see are listed here, and we are going to through all of them. So network access at build time, non-freeness, funny dependencies, assuming you are running DevStack, you know the funny errands of DevStack t-shirt, and no proper releases. So let's go to the first one.
When you build packages in distribution, we have no network access. Don't ask us why. Because we disable it because we want to have reproducible build. That is a big thing in distribution. We have privacy concerns. And also, if you are in desert Iceland, you want to build OpenStack anyway, and you get no networks, except if you use pigeons.
So to continue on that, so one of the things that are indirectly consuming network access is assuming you got Git. So you will, for a reason, use Git in your build process. Or how about doing a query to 3w.google.com? We've seen that a few times. Or downloading whatever blob from the internet just because. Or even worse, like doing a curl pipe bash because you just want to execute something. Yes, it's so fun, right? And how about you change the content of that thing on the address? Another thing that we see over and over again is InterSphinx. So because we have no network access, you can actually use InterSphinx if you want. The only thing that you got to know is that we are going to patch it out. So your doc is going to look ugly with broken links.
And also, we have all this Venice dependency, your own thing stem. Do you think does this really matters? No. Own test runner. Why? And also, all these requirements, depending on the ugly ones, also using the wrong versions or don't caring about the version avatar and distributions. And also, never do that. Changing dependency before GA. Because we are not doing this at this time. We have other things to do. Please. Don't do that.
So dependency versions, it's been a recurring topic over and over again as well. So there is OpenStack within distributions, but OpenStack is not alone. There's other stuff to care about. So if you have a too restrictive upper cap, then probably some other package maintainer will decide to upgrade, I don't know, SQL Alchemy or Django. Something like that, and then it's going to break everything. And there is no way we can reverse that because we are not the only citizen in the distro. The same way, you can have a too restrictive lower bound, which can be problematic for packages that have a lot of reverse dependencies like jQuery or things like that, that we can't just upgrade because it's going to break everything else.
And also, you see this? This is what Thomas sneaked in Oslo Prefsep description, hoping that it would end up in PyPy. And you see, it did end up in PyPy. So please pay attention to what you're doing. We're also having automated tools generating some packages, and it get that in description. And this is bad. So please trim your description. And we'll love you if you do that.
That's it. Yeah, and by the way, you guys are all awesome.
Just want everybody to know, if you've been involved in the dev mailing list, that during this presentation, Thomas was smiling. So I have a picture to prove it. You were smiling during this presentation. So this is all I... Oh yeah, we're using VGA, sorry. Okay.
Oh, yeah, of course. I got it.
Yeah, it fixed it. Do you see it now? That's Netfire.
Here for you.
I've been here.
Of course, there has to be a lightning talk too. Right?
Yeah.
I've never had problems with this before.
What if, can you just mirror? Yeah.
I was doing mirror.
Oh. Oh.
There we go.
Ah, yay! All right. So, yeah. Matthew here is going to tell you about why long live Bash.
Yeah. All right. So, man, this is going to be quick. All right. So, I'm going to give you a quick tour of Bash 8. It was supposed to be using Bash 8, but it's pretty simple. I think you guys will figure it out. So, quick, who am I? I've been working behind the scenes kind of at IBM for 4 years. I've been on OpenStack, deploying it, developing it, more deploying, fixing. And I'm here today because I took a Bash 8.py script from DevStack and turned it into a project, and we'll be talking about that. Mainly I work on, you know, building a lot of DevOps, CI, CD tooling. That's because, you know, most devs can write code. Not everybody can deliver the code effectively, so that's what I find anyway. So what is Bash 8, or formerly Bash 8? If you're curious about the rename, I can talk about that later. So Bash 8 is best described as a style and convention checker for Bash scripts. So it's basically like PEP 8, if you've used that, but for Bash. The output looks very similar. Yeah, you just run it the same, except it doesn't do auto discovery because we had problems. It originally came out of DevStack, and it was written by Sean Daig originally. And it's gone through several evolutions from that. I extracted it basically from DevStack because, I had a lot of Bash scripts internally that I wanted to kind of clean up. You may have this problem as well. I find a lot of people do. So it has a very simple test suite I added, and then it does, obviously, style checking. And it also does some error checking, which is kind of important for DevStack, mainly. Why should you use it? Well, in OpenStack, we really like code quality tooling and like static code analysis, like PEP 8, PyFlakes, Flake 8, hacking, Bash 8. Coding conventions are good. They give you a little bit of familiarity in otherwise unfamiliar code. You know, and I got a couple examples. We always have these conf and log things all over the place in OpenStack code, right? And then readability counts, right? Yeah, and then, of course, Bash 8, this kind of one applies to only Bash 8. It can help you catch a lot of common errors. This is basically what it was designed for. You see a lot of common errors in DevStack, right? In fact, most of the patches that go in are from EN, from finding some weird error pattern that, like, just some strange, like, behavior in Bash that you wouldn't think would be, you know, bad, but it turns out like it'll return something different, you wrap it in parentheses. It's just, you know, very strange things like that that we want to catch and make sure that it doesn't happen. How do you use it? It's pretty easy. You can just, you know, pip install it. That was kind of the main thing about turning it into a project. It's pretty easy to pull down now. You know, and then you just run it on your files, right? Running it manually is pretty simple, but you want to put it in talks, right? If you go look at the devstack.talks.ini, that's a pretty good example, although it's kind of heavyweight too. But you'll get a good example of how to use it and, you know, run it in your CI or, you know, OpenStack CI for you, because that just reads your TalkSini. Yeah, and all my checks are documented basically in the README. And I think we have a man page too. Ian put that out there, which was really nice. More about the project. So, after creation and then adding a test suite, because that's kind of important if you're going to extract a legacy project, we had a large like kind of burst of contributions in the community for, I mean, there were tons of people that wanted to do different things, pluggable checks, like, you know, we had many adopters. The infra guys were running it, Nochi is running it, DevStack obviously is running it, and then there's also many internal projects, you know, I can attest to that. It tends to be slower moving now. Ian's kind of the main maintainer. I kind of just hang around and review his patches when he emails me. and that's mainly because we broke DevStack 8 one time. So break it once, kind of learn, don't do it again. We're still in major version 0, and you know, we try to be open about feedback and patches, but we're not interested in pushing opinions into other projects, so please don't try to do that. I skipped that one. So here's some links and things if you're interested. I would say the main takeaway from this is, you know, this was basically just a small script in Bash, or I mean in DevStack that I extracted. And it turned out to be, you know, a lot of people used it just as soon as creating a project out of it, right? It's not like a big project. There's nothing really sexy about it. It's just a thing that people use because it provides value to a lot of people, because lots of people use Bash. So, and that's all I got, so thanks.
All right, so that concludes our lightning talks. Everybody, thanks for coming, and you are now more prepared for Upstream development with all these presentations by wonderful people. Let's hear it for them again, one more time. Yeah, thank you.